My name is Jesse Jackson. I'm a member of the Cow Creek Band of Umpqua Tribe of Indians. My grandpa, he talked about his grandmother, Grandma Dolly, who lived down from here about a mile down the road in a dirt floor cabin, and was really proud at how she could leave for a month or months at a time with nothing, just the clothes on her back, and could go and make tools and could live off of everything in the forest and off of our flora and our fauna. We're really nature-based people that kept our thumb on the pulse of everything around us, and so we just did what was appropriate. So in areas where we had perennial food sources like tarweed and things like that, we'd burn pretty frequently. In areas that naturally burned, we'd let them naturally burn. Some areas you had to wait for fuel loads to build up, so some areas would be burned every 3 to 5 years just based on where they're at. We have thousands and thousands of years of management by our tribe, and then essentially turning that faucet off in the 1800s, and we have about 200 years now of what's happened after that. I think everybody's kind of in agreement that if we just sit around and do nothing, that we're going to watch all of this forest either die or get extremely unhealthy and then be at real bad fire risk. And so we're trying to regain that balance that we had before, but not trying to do something so fast that we create a new problem by doing so.
So we're on the Jill Hall unit, owned as fee land by the Cow Creek Band of Umpqua Indians. We've worked with them over the last 4 years under a Joint Chiefs program with NRCS and the U.S. Forest Service. So the setting has typically been anywhere from 700 to 1,000 trees per acre of encroaching conifer, Douglas fir. There's a lot of straws in the ground, so to speak, that sucks a lot of water out of the ground, and it provides a lot of competition to the older growth species, the ponderosa pine, the larger oak trees, the larger madrone. So the idea is to try to take out some of those fuel hazards, so when a wildfire comes through, if we can lower that flame length, reduce the fuel load underneath the larger trees, those catastrophic fires, if they decimate the trees, the brush and things, they literally can melt soils. And when that water runs off, the snow melt, it'll take that soil, take it right down slope, create tremendous gullies, and just fill a stream where there's probably a fish bearing capacity is there. And then for years, those fisheries no longer have access to that stream.
So the Elk Creek Watershed Project is very important. I mean, this creek or tributary to the South Umpqua has been deemed by many people as the single most important tributary to the South Umpqua. The fish that came up this creek sustained our people, and we wouldn't have our tribe today if it wasn't for Elk Creek specifically. This lifeblood in the water up here, if we lose Elk Creek, we arguably lose all of the land and all of the life that is associated with the Tiller-Drew area.
So we had really four restoration goals for the project. First one being restoring fire-dependent habitats, so that's primarily meadows and oak pine savanna. Our second goal was to basically treat WUI, wildland urban interface, so that's trying to reduce fuels. Third was we call watershed improvement, so we have a large number of roads in the watershed that negatively impact fisheries. And then the final one was restoring or making resilient our wildlife habitat. With the lack of fire frequency, we were starting to see undergrowth that was negatively impacting our larger, what we call legacy trees.
It was kind of interesting. We had areas that we said we were gonna make this oak savanna and areas that we were gonna make conifer forest, because as you looked in aerial photos, you saw a conifer forest. But the idea was to always release oaks as we saw them, and we'd get into some of these areas and we'd see these huge oaks and we'd have to start releasing them, and we realized pretty quickly that most of this project wasn't going to be just thinning a conifer forest, it was restoring oak savanna. The good thing about these projects is, yeah, there's some cultural aspects as far as there's going to be some plants and that kind of stuff that the tribe had traditionally gathered, and that's important to the tribe, but then there's also the ecological aspect. When we first came in, there was hardly any sign of wildlife in here, because all the green stuff that anything would eat was, you know, 40 feet in the air. We drove in today, we saw deer in here. And that's within just a couple of years, those deer are moving back into these meadows. There's elk that have been using this, and we've seen bear in here.
That's part of their food sovereignty goal, is more access to hunting and more things that they can collect from the land That's another measure of success, is if we've gotten them into that position to where their members can actually use this land and walk the land and do what they used to do, then that's kind of the point, okay, I'm moving on to the next project with the tribe.
We're just starting to see, you know, a few results. We're seeing little oak seedlings coming back. We're also seeing a larger brush component. And some people might think, well, you know, you're trading large trees for brush and grass. Is that a good thing? In terms of wildlife habitat, yes. In terms of fire control, actually dealing with grass and brush field models is easier than dealing with heavy timber.
There's a saying, you know, ridges, roads, and rivers is often where we plan for a lot of fuels work to try to prevent or slow down a wildfire. And so a lot of our river corridors are private. A lot of our ridges are public. A lot of our roads are both. And that aspect, to address all of those features, you have to work with all lands.
So when you team up with federal entities like NRCS, you get super knowledgeable people about specific parts of forest that honestly we don't have the staff and resources to do in our tribe. By us diversifying the amount of players in the table, we have diverse amount of education and diverse amounts of experience and diverse amounts of resources, because the reality is if we don't have resources, then we can't make much happen.
If you were trying to affect change at a landscape level, so by having those projects, both Forest Service, private, tribal, that just allows us to treat the landscape in a more holistic fashion.
We still try to talk with the tribal members because it's their land, and my job as a forester is to manage the land in the boundaries of the landowner's expectations.
We belong to the land, right? And so the importance of the land to the people can't actually be stated in words from a native. Because the land is what makes us, and so we don't exist without the land.